Tryharder is an automated League of Legends coach designed to get you climbing that ranked ladder. Focusing on farming, fighting, and objective control, Tryharder uses hundreds of metrics to create personalized solutions to the problem areas in your game. Every time you play a ranked game, Tryharder will crunch your numbers and adjust your coaching accordingly. You can set your own goals, track your progress, and win more games. Sign up today. Try harder. Be better.
Hey guys, what is up? Aoki here, bringing you a new coaching session. This time it is for a currently mid-gold Nami player by the name of Web Spider. Going to be going over everything from itemization to playstyle to strategies and teaching this player how to climb to platinum and beyond. So if this is your first time on the channel, my name is Aoki. I'm a Grandmaster support player, and I currently think at the time of recording, it is, I believe, on patch 10.7. I think Nami is incredibly strong. So now is a great time to pick up Nami. Before we get into the actual gameplay, I wanted to cover runes. So currently, Web Spider, you are running Sorcery and Precision secondary with Presence of Mind and I believe Legend of Tenacity. I would definitely X that out. There are two currently very strong rune pages for Nami. That is the Airy page, so Sorcery, and then as a secondary page, you could go Resolve or Inspiration. Or the other page you could go is a Guardian page, which against into all-in champions such as, you know, Leona, Alistar, Thresh, Guardian is a very good option. Running Airy with a Precision secondary page is very, very risky against a champion like Thresh, but these are the runes that we have. I just wanted to let you know that there are better alternatives out there. So this is a Nami Misfortune into Thresh Jhin. So right off the bat, I want to commend you on your proactivity. That's always something that I try to teach in my support games. Get there first, even if your team is AFK in the fountain. Get to your games on time. Ward against invades. Do everything you can that takes it out of your teammates' hands. So you covered this entrance and you stood here. So that's really, really good. You know, your other options are to sit here and ward over this wall. That way you see invades from this way and this way. But you got this covered, so good job. So, you always want to be thinking about how the lane is going to go. What spell are you going to start? What are trades going to look like? So we've got a Nami MF with Exhaust into a Thresh Jhin with Ignite. This is a lane that you lose if you get caught. So you want to be aggressive as you can with your poke, but you don't want to be like suicidal. You don't want to be walking into them and dying to flay or anything. All right, let me get the volume turned up a little bit so we can hear some sound effects. All right, so jungler is starting other side of the map. Not sure why that's still not playing. Interesting. So, right off the bat, we know Thresh started Hook. That's really good for us because guess what? He doesn't have Hook. So, what are you going to do? Auto, W, there you go. There you go. Good aggression from level 1. Very, very nice. Thresh has a relatively long cooldown on his Hook, and it's way more normal for him to start his Flay because that gives him the empowered autos and it gives him the ability to outtrade you. If he starts Hook level 1, you need to do exactly what you just did. You need to be aggressive. You need to push. So in my coaching sessions, I'm going to be pointing out the things that you're doing well so that you can keep doing them, capitalize on them. Oh my god. Turns out you do quite a lot well in the early levels. Really, really good play from you early on. Landed a double bubble. Very nice. You push the wave, you push for two, you abuse the fact that Thresh started in not great ability, and he missed the ability. So you've got this laning phase is going really, really well. I'm not sure why I can hear like the ambience noise, but not the actual like abilities. Sorry about that. Alright, so let's go over what just happened, because this is exactly what you don't want to be doing. Had a very strong level 1. The only way that Thresh can engage after your good trades level 1 is if you get caught while your ADC is warding outside of your minion wave. So this is literally the only way things can go poorly for you. So looks like you're going to be giving first blood. Jhin barely gets out. So you're just caught outside of your minion wave. When you have such a good level one, you need to be doing, you need to be practicing something called matching the aggression of your ADC. So you need to, typically, you need to be able to draw a parallel line between you and your ADC. If she's not right here, you can't be up here. If she's back here, you need to be back here. So something I see low elo players do a lot is stand too far behind or too far ahead of the marksman, because she isn't able to immediately provide presence, which is the only way that Thresh went in. The only reason that Thresh went in to begin with. Like, you salvaged it as much as you could. You know, you landed your bubble, you landed your exhaust, but you shouldn't have put yourself in that position in the first place. Obviously, if you're behind your minions, the only thing that Thresh can do is flash flay you, which is still not ideal, but is going to be end up being way better than this. So it looks like you guys get 2-for-1. Okay. 2-for-1. Still not terrible. The game is certainly not lost or won off of that play. Handing a W to our jungler. So typically, as support, especially against a catch champion like Thresh, you want to be rushing boots. You did not have enough gold when you went back to get boots, so we just picked up what we could. But yeah, obviously giving yourself the mobility advantage giving yourself the ability to dodge the Thresh hook is what keeps you alive. As long as you're not getting landed on by Thresh hook, you do not die in this lane. So let's talk about your role in the laning phase, but let's look a little bit ahead, and we'll get to those and we'll break them down when we get to actual team fighting. But your role is Nami. Nami is kind of like an interesting character because she brings sustain, she brings poke, and she brings follow up. She's not necessarily a great hard engage. She's not a Blitzcrank or a Leona where her abilities come out super fast. The bubble is very hard to land. To land a bubble, it requires three things. It requires knowledge of where they're going to walk, so like prediction. It requires you to be good at the champion, and it requires luck. Because no matter how good you are, you will not predict the way that they walk every single time. There's things to make it easier to land your bubble, such as using your E and autoing them, or using your E and Wing them, because they did rework Nami, and now when you E yourself, spells also slow. And then use the Q. So, that'll make it so you land most of your bubbles. But a lot of the time, you're shooting these raw bubbles, and it's really hard. You shouldn't ever rely on that. So in the grand scheme of things, when you're in team fights, you should wait for other people to CC. She's excellent at following up. She can turn a subpar hard engage from like a Darius or even a Jarvan knockup into an amazing engage that they're CC'd for like 3 seconds straight. Because if they make it easy for you to land your bubble, you bubble, you know you landed it because they're already CC'd, then you dump your wave, and all of a sudden they're CC'd for 3 to 4 seconds, and they're probably dead. So you're not trying to play the role of engage, you're trying to poke, you're trying to sustain, and trying to follow up. That's your role as Nami. Okay, right around now, you need to be backing out. You realize that Thresh is aggressive. He's not going to let you clear the ward. You don't know where their jungler's at. Worst case scenario, all you need to think about the worst case scenario. Their jungler's right here. Thresh gets you hooked while you're greeting for this ward. You see? And he's already got the angle on you. By the time you realize, the second you see him leave the minion wave and you realize he's coming to get you at the ward, that's when you need to start backing up. It takes way, way too long for you yourself to clear the ward. So, right around here, it's not a bad idea to go over here and pressure this ward, because obviously, you're trying to work with your jungler, trying to get the vision out so J4 can gank. So right around here, we see Thresh is not having any of that and is immediately coming to the control ward. You get one auto, you're like, oh, Thresh is not going to let me have it. Because by the time you react to it right here, it's too late. He already has the angle. If he was a really good Thresh, he would just hook you there. And it would come down to whether or not you can dodge the hook, and that decides if you get the live or not. So even though you didn't get punished there, that doesn't matter. You should have died there. And that's what we're here to coach. Okay, once again, don't think this is going to actually hit. Think you're a little bit too fast. But once again, you're finding yourself outside of your minion wave against Thresh. Worst case scenario here, you react to it a quarter second too late, you get hooked here outside of your minion wave, he lanterns in a jungler, and you're dead. Very, very rarely should you ever be outside of the minion wave walking around Thresh like that. He simply can't. He doesn't have flash, so he can't flash flay you. The only way he fights, the only way he wins this as an all-in champion, is if he catches you outside the minion wave. So you're spending way, way, way too much time outside of it. I know it's very, very tempting to walk up and, you know, harass him, but if you don't have a minion wave that you can stand in, you can't do it. Alright, so they have vision. You have to assume they're coming. You have to assume they're coming. Alright, not a terrible bubble here. Oh, they stole the dragon. Not much you could have done differently there. Only thing you could have done differently is really, like, hold the bubble until, like, you're actually going to do something with it. Like, you bubbling Thresh there inconveniences him for, like, a quarter second. Whereas, like, if you had held it, maybe J4 EQs Qiyana after she steals it. You guys kill Qiyana and you trade a dragon for the jungler. But, okay, once again, you're lucky that he hooked the minion. But think about the worst case scenario here, right? Look at where you're positioning. Your parallel line with your ADC is okay. You're very parallel with her. But worst case scenario, you get hooked right here. If you had thrown it a little bit better, you died there again. So that's the biggest mistake I'm seeing in your laning phase, is that you're just giving Thresh way too many opportunities. Like, there's just no reason for you to give him these opportunities. You're not reliant, since you went Relic Shield, you're not reliant on the poke, so you don't need to be playing aggressive to get your gold from your Spell Thieves. So, just play super, you know, safer against this. Yep, there it is. You open your up outside your minion wave again. As your minion wave dies, you need to be walking backwards. MF had the right idea here. Looks like you're going to be collecting another death. So that's, honestly, that's the biggest and most easily fixed problem. This is honestly good. I know this sounds mean, and it seems like it's not good because I'm telling you that your laning phase is terrible, but this is a very easily fixable problem. Most players have problems that are more abstract. You've got a very easy problem to fix. You're just standing outside of your minion wave. So you fix that, and this is a totally different game, right? Alright, I like the boot rush. So let's talk about itemization. Not sure what you're going to build on Nami, but just while we don't have much to do in lane while we're alone, let's go ahead and talk about what we're going to be building. Right now, core build on Nami is Athene's into full AP. You know, that may vary on if you ask other players. I'm playing Nami in high elo, and I'm telling you, Athene's into any full AP item is really, really good. I'm talking you can go death cap. Zhonya's wouldn't be terrible here. Athene's, insanely high gold value item. Don't get trapped into building Ardent. A lot of people are still stuck on that Ardent. They're thinking that we're still in Season 7 or whenever Ardent's meta was. That item does not matter anymore. It is a big noob trap item. Alright, so we're walking down with our jungler, walking down with our jungler. We just saw Thresh at their red. Not going to be able to make too much happen here unless Thresh comes and checks this. Alright, excellent. Like I said, I want to focus on the good because you're doing a lot of good. From judging on everything that I've said so far, what did you just do correctly here? I'm not sure how correct the decision is to be doing this. This is a little sketch just because we don't know where the jungler is. But tell me what you think. Pause the video if you have to and tell me what you think you did correctly there. You waited for him to already be CC'd. You took luck out of the equation. You took the necessity to predict it out of the equation. And it works so much better, doesn't it? It works so much better. You guys get the Thresh. Excellent. So many Namis. I will see so many Namis just try to predict where Thresh is going to go. And guess what? When you get into good elos, players will walk up to the bush and then walk backwards because they know that there's traps like that. So it's very, very good that you didn't just try to like predict where Thresh is going to go, his path, and throw the bubble there. You wait until he was already CC'd. I'm going to point it out every single time you do it because it's so, so, so important that you do that. You understand that she is a follow-up champion. Alright, so we're pushing this, and I mean that when you've got time in a 2v1 like this, it's not necessarily terrible to do prediction bubbles like that because you're not risking anything, right? If you land it, you know, MF can drop the E, the auto, maybe an alt, maybe you get his flash or something. I don't think you'd kill him there, but it's okay to be doing that. I have no problem with that. It's when you, if you, now if you ever throw those bubbles out in a 2v2 situation where Threshkin has a very large, very well-defined window of opportunity to punish you for it, then it's bad. Like, if you were to just throw a random bubble right now, then it's really bad, because you need to hold on to that bubble as a get-me-out card. Okay, so, you didn't wait for them to be CC'd. They're about to be CC'd, but you didn't wait for them to be. So now we have no knock-up, we have no bubble, and it's a very sloppy dive. Turns out it works out okay, but if you had waited for them to either be sharked or knocked up by J4, you wouldn't miss the bubble. I'm also noticing you're not really using the Nami combos to kind of like secure bubbles. The Nami combos, what I mean by that is that Alt-E, if you hold down the Alt button, that means it self-targets. Alt-E, so you've got your E on yourself, you auto them once, and then you immediately bubble. And the slow from the E makes it pretty darn hard to miss the bubble. Okay, this should just be a dead Thresh. All right, there we go. Good job. No idea what that guy was doing, but this isn't Thresh's coaching session. There you go. There's the E. Another E. Okay, maybe the bubble wasn't up. Was there a bubble up here? Okay, our bubble is up. I'm not seeing you throw it. So E bubble is the right call here. And this is actually a really, really good place to bubble him. Because you there, like I said before, there's a level of prediction when it comes to bubbles. But you've eliminated, by him putting himself against the wall and having no flash, he can't dodge this way. So the only way he dodges is this way, or this way. This way kills him because he's moving towards MF. That's the threat he's trying to run away from. This, if you throw it like slightly behind him, he either has to move this way and secure his own death, or walk into the bubble and secure his own death. But I'm not sure why we're like stalling to throw bubble here. You've landed the E, Q. Like, we waited way, way, way too long to bubble here. Yeah, way, way, way too long to bubble here. So let's talk about how that could have gone differently. We've got him in an ideal situation, right? He's been baited. You were baiting here. The idea was correct. The execution was not correct. So we've got options. We can either open with Alt right here. You won't miss that. I guarantee you won't miss that. Or you could go the route that you went with the auto E slow into bubble, and you probably won't miss that either. Whatever we did instead here is not the way to go. This would have been a very easy ocean. You know, you shoot the ocean right here. Once again, he has to either eat it and die or walk towards MF and die. Instead, you kind of allowed him to, like, hardcore outplay you 2v1, but it's in the past now. And because of that, MF dies 1v1 or alone under a turret. All right, CDR boots. I like the build. It looks like you've got a good grasp on itemization. When you the concept of buying boots as fast as you can in most matchups, but it's definitely against a Thresh. You had presence here for your fish. You should get out here. You should get out. Yep. Do you get out? I'm not sure you guys. Ornn went back in. Okay, so Ornn should just die here. Yep, free kill on Ornn. I like the presence that you had. You saw someone was in danger. You didn't just go back to your lane and be like, my idiot mid laner is feeding. You actually had presence. It's a hard concept to teach for a lot of people, so it's good to see. You've honestly got a lot of really good fundamentals. See, that's the bubble we wanted to see earlier. Do you understand how good that is? Because he's got two options. He eats the bubble and dies, or he walks this way and dies. It's perfect. That's exactly what you should have done here. So good. Good job. One more note about itemization. I actually kind of like Mikhail's into Thresh. But you probably don't want to be doubling down on Enchanter items and going Mikhail's and Athene's. It's not the worst thing to do, but against Thresh, specifically against Thresh, just because, you can usually tell if a hook is about to hit. And I don't know if you know this or not, but there's actually an advanced technique with Mikhail's where if you self cast it, same way you put your E on yourself, if you press Alt and then whatever hotkey you have on Mikhail's, say you have it in the first slot of your items, Alt 1, right before the hook hits you, you can cleanse that hook off of you. You can do that with any stun. Qiyana stun, Twisted Fate, Gold Card, everything. A lot of people don't know that. And the reason a lot of people don't know it is because once the hook has hit you and it's CCing you, you can't use the item. But there's a little bit of a buffer. It's about half of a second. So I do kind of like Mikhail's. Once you get good at using that item, it's actually really good against Thresh. You can also cleanse hooks off of, you know, your allies. It's just really good. So once again, we used our bubble. We used our bubble a little bit incorrectly. She doesn't get out because of it, but it would have been way easier to use your bubble as follow-up on the J4 EQ. Let's see if you do it here. Okay? Oh, we're not bubbling at all. Okay, doesn't matter. Alright. So it's a little... Oh! Cheeky. Cheeky bubble. So it's a little, we're not going to be talking about too much macro in this game because Nami isn't a very strong roamer. You can go Mobis, but against a Dart or against a Vlad, I wouldn't have roamed at all in this game either. I think this is the MF just kind of overstaying. The one thing that can be said about this is that you need to commit to what your team is committing to. If you were around here, you might have been able to save the MF. You guys probably should have just came back for this turret later. But by you kind of like being in this bush and, oh, I'm going to channel a recall. Oh, now I'm going to go help the dragon. I think you probably should have stayed on the same page with the MF. Because I don't think she would have died there. It's getting a little bit Fiesta-ish. Here we go. Landed an easy follow-up bubble. Good job, good job. Is there a reason we're not blocking for J4 there? Okay, so... good bubble. You can't miss it. He's already CC'd. Good job. But we're getting Jhin ulted. Get in front of him. Get in front of him. Don't be trying to dodge this. He's not shooting for you. You're not the target. So yeah, definitely should have blocked that one. The fourth shot does execution damage, so if he's in execution range, you should definitely be blocking with your 75% health left. Alright, so we've got our Athenes. You want to be charging your Athenes. So the way that Athenes works, you do have to actually keep damaging the enemy. That was a really good bubble though. You do want to be like consistently Wing the enemy, and you can use your allies to bounce it off them, but you constantly want to be damaging the enemies. So while you're that close to Ornn, there's no reason to like not be gathering blood charges by autoing him and using W on him and things like that. Because by dealing damage to the enemy, think of it that way. Think of it this way. If you're dealing damage to the enemy, you're gathering your blood charges for your Athenes, and your next Athenes heal will do a ton more healing. So by dealing damage, you're actually healing. It's kind of like a recurring theme with Nami, honestly, because W does both of them. All right. So let's talk about how to use our exhaust. Exhaust is insanely more useful against champions with very clearly defined windows of damage. So champions like Vlad, you can pretty much always know when they're about to deal their big bursty damage, right? Because he'll ultimate. The second he ultimates, that's when you want to use your exhaust. The second, for example, a champion like Zed ultimates on you, that's when you want to use your exhaust. Gets a little trickier when you get champions like LeBlanc, who can W in, get exhausted, and then W out, and just choose to not use her damage. But you pretty much know when a Vlad is doing this to your ADC, that's when you want to dump your exhaust. Exhaust, 16 minutes into the game, it's already outscaled Ignite. So I do think exhaust is a much stronger summoner spell than Ignite, but yeah, you have to actually use it. And I think that this is just like a lack of understanding of Vlad's kit and when his damage is coming out. I don't blame you for missing the bubble because that's a hard bubble. And like I said, you're simply never going to land all of them. There's a matter of luck and prediction attached to it. But you can't miss exhaust. So be sure to throw it out there when you know that there's a very well-defined window of damage. Okay, so this is a little bit greedy. I understand you wanting to have presence for your Fizz, but you need to understand that he's going to places that you cannot follow. There is now 4 enemies between you and Fizz. He's on his own, right? You need to understand you've got limits. So, outside of your minion wave... Oh, and we wasted our flash. That's a big bummer. So that was just a matter of understanding Vlad's limits. I think that might be one of the biggest things that you're struggling with, is understanding your limits as a champion and understanding the other champion's limits, because that was 2 consecutive plays in a row that, like, it didn't feel like you understood your or Vlad's limits. Okay, that's good. Stop is back. That's an underrated skill as well. That's something that a lot of people... Okay, now you're risking it. This is way outside of your limits. You get hooked by Thresh here and you die. All right, doing it to Ornn when he's isolated, that's fine. Ornn doesn't have a hook. Thresh does. You should have died here. So again, I'm not coaching what actually happened. I'm coaching what should have happened. You should have died there. So understand your limits as Nami. And it's difficult because there's so many things that go into League of Legends. I understand. But, champions like Leona have far different limits than Nami. She can go to places that Nami can't. Nami is always, no matter what runes or build you have, Nami's always going to be easy to kill. So you need to learn how to position and learn your limits. when you can and can't go up and harass people. Think of it this way as a rule of thumb. If you are ever able to be hooked as Thresh, you're probably positioning incorrectly. If there is ever a direct line between you and Thresh, that's not the correct place. Okay, so once again, direct line between you and Thresh. When these guys are all coming from this way, you need to be pivoting around here. Staying within range of J4, who hopefully gets this dragon. Oh my god, that's tilting. And pivoting around. Staying within useful range. Okay, J4 is in a different place now, right? The situation has changed. You can't follow him anymore. You're out of there. Good disengage. Good disengage. They're bowing a lot on you. I think you might get out. You might get out. Okay, nice. So that was good. You realize the situation changed. You can no longer, under any circumstances, help J4. This is good. See? This is exactly where you want to be in a team fight. This is exactly where you want to be in a team fight. Bouncing W's onto the enemy from your backline. It's perfect. It's perfect. Oh, you thought about going that way. I'm glad you didn't. I'm glad you didn't. Okay, we're chasing. And perfect. Okay, so let's talk about back timers. Because you don't want to be on this part of the map. This is what Darius is doing. He's splitting. Not only are you costing him solo experience, you're not getting to back now. And you just put yourself in danger again. So after a fight like that, rule of thumb, you're backing. You want to go back. You want to spend your gold. You don't want to still be out here. You definitely don't still want to be out here. It doesn't matter that this just worked. This is not where you're supposed to be on the map. You want to be thinking about the next objective, which is probably going to be Baron. And you want to be getting out Vision safely over here. But since you didn't back when you should have, now no one is over here to assist you in getting Vision. And it's very scary to get Vision by yourself as Nami. So important back timings are very, very important. Especially as an Enchanter support. So you guys get some free cleanups. Ooh. Good. Nice. Good use of your summoners to survive. Using your W on yourself. You want to take this turret and immediately back. Actually, the four dead. Okay, I didn't realize I've been fast forwarding a lot, so I forgot that we're 22 minutes into the game. Death timers are definitely high enough to get the inhibitor here. Okay. I like what you did here. I don't know if you actually did it consciously, but I like that you did not stack and make MF an even more viable target. When an Ornn goes and is about to ult you, you typically want to spread out and not be on top of the person that you're most afraid of dying. She's basically your most valuable asset at this stage of the game. So you don't want to stand on top of her and be like, well, make Ornn think like, well, there's no reason to not ult MF now. I mean, I also get a bonus Nami. Okay, so at this stage of the game, it's kind of going full Fiesta. People are getting caught left and right. Back. It's this type of dilly-dallying and not knowing where to be that's costing you your back timers. You just back here. You go back. You should have about 1,000 gold. You go B. Nope. What are you doing? You're mid. You're dilly-dallying. Have better back timers. The faster you back, the faster you can get back out onto the map with full mana. With an item up on your enemy. With a full set of wards. Alright, looks like we're going for Death Cap possibly? Yeah, Death Cap with Needless. Wow, I like it. Big boy build. Alright, so Dragon is the next objective. We just saw Qiyana around here. So we're going to be very careful about around these edge of walls, right? See Qiyana in the dragon pit. We're going to position on the other side of Darius because we don't want to get hooked. We never want to be able to draw a line between Thresh and you. All right, there's their third dragon. Never want to be able to draw a line between Thresh and you. Good job. Okay. Alright, let's talk about what we could have done differently here. It's not going to be too much, because you're basically just committing to what your team is doing here. It's a little harder to, like, lead by example when you're not playing, like, a hard engaged champion like Thresh or Blitzcrank or Leona. The only thing you really could have done is you don't need to be this close to MF, especially because you can bounce it off of any champion, enemy, or ally, and it's going to heal her. So there's no real reason to be this clumped with her. But this was just a poor fight. This was just a bad fight chosen by your team. Fiesta. We're not here to coach the Fiesta. We're here to coach you. So you back out on the map. Let's see what we're working with. We lost half of our Medjai Soul Stealers. So I'm not usually a big fan of actually fully upgrading Medjais on Nami just because they can just overcommit and lose you like a ton of AP, gold investment, all that jazz. I will find myself sometimes buying Dark Seal and then selling it later in the game. Just because, like, there's not a whole lot of things you can buy with 300 gold as a, 350 gold as a support. So sometimes it's just, like, a convenient buy. Okay, so they're down an ultimate now. They're down Vladimir ultimate. We're hovering between two sets of allies. It's good, we're getting vision out. Ay, and we're backing when we should be. Nice. Throw those wards down, get vision, and then reset. Nothing's happening on the map, so that was a good back. Good job. Oh. Okay. Pretty decent wave. There we go. Ooh, good bubble too. Very nice bubble, actually. Whew. It's a risky one. It was a good bubble. Kept that Qiyana from straight destroying your MF. We're playing doctor. We're keeping as many people alive as we can. Jin. Okay. Whoopsies. this game has just gone full fiesta. I like your positioning here. I like it. I like the presence. You didn't leave him. But you still didn't leave too many opportunities for you to get hooked. Okay, here's my one complaint. You did walk all the way back to base despite you having blue buff. I'm guessing you might have bought your death caps, your Rabidons. I don't think you should be putting this many people outside of Baron reaction range, right? And you definitely shouldn't be walking boss side. We don't have any vision on Baron. And we actually see particle effects. This is not just a spectator bug either. This is things that you can actually see in game. Sometimes you don't have vision on Baron, and certain spells will activate particle effects, so we can see they're on Baron. And I'm not sure you guys should be giving Baron at a point like this. So hopefully that didn't come to a shock as your team that they did Baron, because we saw them. We are in a good spot to deny them soul. But you don't want to fight this because it's a 4v5. You don't want to fight this because it's a 4v5. So spam ping your team. Don't be afraid to be that person that spam pings. You noticed J4 was being an idiot, and you did not try to... That's good. That's good. You didn't go down with him. I'm not seeing a lot of pings coming out of you, and I get criticized all the time for being a huge spam pinger. I ping, like, literally 700 times a game. Like, that probably isn't even an exaggeration. Be the guy that's constantly red spam ping when someone's in danger. Don't be afraid to communicate with your team. All right, this is good. This is good follow-up. And boom, got the Thresh. Good job. Excellent. Nami is very, very... Nami and Zyra are probably two of the supports that are hardest to dive. Maybe might put, like, Jhin and Lulu in there as well. But, man, she's got such crazy disengage that you can stand way back here. And if a fight ensues out here and they have to fight it here, you can get, like, a five-man wave. It's crazy. Good job. Okay, got the Vlad. Now we empower the MF because she's walking forward. Good job. With the E on him. Just run these guys down. Good job, good job. Throw the bubble, and he's done. So I just want to show you how effective of an item Athene's is. You've done 4,000 extra healing with that item. So on top of the AP that gives you extra heals with your W, on top of the MR, on top of the mana regen, on top of the cooldown, it's done 4,000 extra healing. Can you imagine building Ardent Sensor over that item? Jeez. I know you don't, so this isn't a rant directed towards you, but man, there's so many people that build Ardent Sensor with Nami. Drives me crazy. Wow, this Darius is big. Big boy. Only thing I can really criticize there is that you were in range for a flay. Once MF is caught, position over here or back here. Be in range. Be in range to still help her, W her. But you did get hit by the same flay. So you don't want to make it easy on him. It's kind of the same theory as, like, not stack when Ornn ults, you don't want to stack right on top of MF. It's kind of the same thing to a lesser degree with the Thresh Flay. Because sometimes that Thresh Flay will mean, like, you die with her. Alright, so we've got fully stacked Medjays, we've got Rabidons. We are doing big boy damages. So I want to point out why. You might just be building full AP Nami without understanding why it's so good. So let's take a pause in the action. Look over your W, and the very last paragraph there bounces to each target only once and hits up to three targets. The damage and healing value is modified by 33% each bounce. Yeah, usually that says negative. Usually that's like negative 20, negative 10%, negative 5%, depending on how much AP you have. Once you get enough AP, that goes above zero. You stop getting penalized for the bounces, and they start doing more damage and healing for bounces. So when you're getting three-person bounces in team fights, each one does more. It's crazy. The champion just scales so well with AP. So just want you to understand why you're building full AP. Wanted to make sure you knew that. Because you don't want to just like build things without, because someone told you to, without like actual, you know, reasoning and numbers backing it up. In the same way that you don't want to like lock in the same runes every single game without understanding why you're doing it. All right, so you guys are just running them down. Okay. I will say, I think you used the W on yourself here. At this stage of the team fight, that is probably not a good idea. I think you W'd yourself. Fizz was in pretty dire need of one. Okay. So I think at this stage of the game, you guys just kind of walk it in, right? So it didn't cost you there, but once again, you're kind of like throwing bubbles, just kind of hoping they land. When you have pretty reliable CC, you had the Darius pull. You could have just waited and then landed your follow-up. So just get into the mindset of, unless you're just fishing, and I don't use that as a, no pun intended, unless you're fishing, like throwing out a Q just because like it doesn't cost you anything if it doesn't hit, you should really wait for your bubbles, because you're about to have CC, right? If you had saved your bubble for when the shark hit or when the wave hits, you could have comboed that. One of them might be dead right now. So just try to get into that understanding of that. Your role is typically follow-up. She's so much stronger if you use her as follow-up engage or disengage. Also, I don't believe you bought a stopwatch. I buy stopwatch almost every single game. It's an insanely high gold value item, because you can save your shutdowns, you can save your Medjis. You can do a lot with stopwatch. Even if you don't end up building it into Zhonya's, just crazy, crazy good item. It was just unfortunate timing on the Zhonya's. But if you had waited for him to be knocked up by the Jarfin EQ, you could have landed easy bubble. Nice. Alright, so I think at this point we just walk it in. So let's go ahead and go over what I want you to be working on. Understanding your role as Nami, understanding that she is a sustain, poke, follow-up champion rather than the hard engage. Want you to understand why you're building full AP. I do want you to stick to that build, though. Try out the Zhonya's, though. Try to at least buy a stopwatch, even if you're not turning into the full Zhonya's. I think it's just such a great item on Nami. And swap out those precision secondary runes, because you want inspiration or you want resolve in your secondary tree. Presence of mind is not going to be worth it. You don't struggle with mana as much in the late game, since you're already building at least one enchanter item, which gives you base mana regen, and you've got the area with the mana flow band. You don't need presence of mind, and the second rune is just kind of going to waste. So if you have any questions, just let me know. I hope you learned something. I hope you guys watching at home learned something, and take it easy, guys. Peace.